Yeah. Revenge ain't sweet. Trust me. Yeah. I've been up sleepless nights and it ain't like me.
So we're here to celebrate 50 years of hip hop today with Avirex and Metropolis. How are you feeling about performing tonight?
Yeah, I'm feeling good. Album's been out for a few weeks now. It's always nice to get in front of people and learn the songs, because I don't even know some of the lyrics and that, but it will be good fun, man. Gassed to be at Metropolis, obviously iconic studio, with Avirex as well, iconic brand, man, so special times.
Yeah. Hip-hop, obviously, 50 years old, sort of as this is going out and celebrations are kind of running through the year. When do you remember when you first discovered hip-hop, or when it discovered you?
Yeah. It's probably MTV base. I used to watch a lot growing up. I grew up in Custom House, East London, and at the time I wasn't actually allowed to play out that much, so didn't really know what my brethren was consuming that locally. But I had MTV base on all day, and that's how I got introduced to like hip hop music videos, basically the Diddy's, you know what I'm saying, like Nate Dogg's. Ludacris, those kind of artists, and it just drew me in straight away, like the colourful nature of it, the different subject matters, and I was in from then really, and I always kind of gravitated towards like two different parts of hip-hop. One part was like the flow and like the sauciness.
Speaking of Diddy, when you were backstage you put the Avirex on, you said that you felt like it. What are some memories of the brand and stuff that you have from the past?
I guess from a hip-hop perspective, Biggie's one of my favourite rappers. I'll never forget, I saw this one image, I need to try and find it, of him sitting in a whip. He's got like a red Avirex on, and he's just kind of leaning back like this, just looking mad cool. And I just remember thinking, oh, that looks hard, yeah. But obviously, like, Council of State culture, my parents coming from Ghana to the UK, we didn't really have much money, so actually like owning an Avirex was never an option for me. But one thing I thought that was sick is in my local area, I'm from East London, a lot of the grime artists started having like Avirex in their music videos and stuff. And I remember going to like raves at Stratford Rex, I'd see like More Fire Crew, Lethal B, I'd see Dizzy, everyone was wearing Avirexes now. So it became something that I attributed to like success within music. So that's one of them things that was always like, when I get the peas to get one, I'm gonna cop it, and I never did in the end, so like, big up Avirex, man.
Yeah, so how does it feel to be wearing it today?
I think for the first time in a long time, I feel like a real rapper, man. It feels good, man.
So, yeah, so those artists that you mentioned before and stuff, I guess you were watching MTV Bass and you were kind of consuming hip-hop. When do you think the transition happened to you creating and to becoming a part of it yourself?
Yeah, man. I think Kano was like a big part of me wanting to create music. He had a song called P's and Q's that I saw the video of on bass, and then I thought to myself, right, that's a brother that's like 10 minutes down the road and he's doing his thing and he's writing about life from the perspective of a guy in East London. I could be doing the same thing. And then around the same time, Wretch 3-2 was starting to really blow up, and he had a song called, it was Can't Say Sorry, I think it was called. And then I thought, right, sick, because with hip hop, a lot of the times people think it's quite one dimensional. So you can only rap about like chicks and drugs and money and that kind of stuff. But I guess there was a few artists that were showing me different subject matters, and I felt like it was important for people from backgrounds like mine to talk about those deeper topics over rap music, man. So I'd say Kano and Wretch were a big part of me wanting to write my own bars.
Yeah, because you mentioned those two different kind of aspects of the flows and the kind of swag and then sort of the lyrics, but I guess I feel like there used to be a belief maybe that you had to choose one, whereas I don't know what your view is on that. It doesn't really feel like that's true.
Nah, I don't think they're mutually exclusive, and I think my favourite type of artists are artists that do both of that really well. So that's why Jay-Z, obviously you got the flows, but then he'll delve into different subject matters as well. Nas the same. More recently, you've got like Kendrick Lamar, J. Cole. So yeah, my favorite kind of artists are technically on like a rap level, they can hold their own, but then they talk about various different things that make you think and help you through, you know what I mean, difficult times in your life, great times in your life, that kind of stuff.
Yeah. I was interested listening to your record, The Village Is on Fire, you've written books and stuff. You could have put those ideas into something else. It feels like when you listen to the record, there's like a thesis laid out with the first song, and you're going to delve into this topic in depth. What is it that makes it become rap music?
I think with rap, I've just got a unique gift of concisely communicating a message without saying that many words. Like, a book's great, it's like 60,000 words, get to delve deep. And I guess with this album, what happened to me in terms of like the attack and stuff, didn't feel like it needed to be a book, but it just felt like I wanted to grab people's attention with the music, say what I had to say, and then bounce. And so, yeah, I just viewed it very cinematically, and it just felt like it was best consumed in rap form.
Because obviously you get that bit of advice from your cousin to write it down. Is that, you know, is hip-hop therapy to you in that way?
Yeah, music's like hugely cathartic, but I also think that we're all wired differently. So for my cousin, for like Michaela, she'll always prefer like writing a TV series, for example, because that's what comes most naturally to her. And for me, rapping is always like my go-to. It was actually my English teacher in primary school that told me like I had a gift for writing. And since then, going from like writing stories to writing music, I always knew that rap is like first and foremost the easiest way that I can communicate my feelings, and most importantly, like process what I'm going through as well. So yeah, I love like all the extracurricular stuff like books, but like rap's always going to be my number one, man.
Yeah, because you talk on the album about that teacher sort of pushing you to write story after story and stuff. What's your writing process like now? Do you output a lot, or is it more?
Yeah, it's actually changed, you know. So when I was like first starting out, I would go studio every day. I'd write about everything and anything. I just loved the sport of being an MC, being a rapper. And now I'm like a bit more experienced, and I've been doing that for a long time. I just feel like I only write when I get inspired to. Like, so I could not go studio for 6 months because I need to live life and experience some stuff before I can write about it. I don't know, maybe I'm getting on a bit, man. But I can only like make music when I feel it inside, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So it's less for the practice of writing, more because you've got something to say.
Yeah, man. And maybe, like, not to sound big-headed, but I feel like I've put in my 10,000 hours on like a technical scale. If you want to do like the flows thing, we can do that. If you want to do like the radio sets, we can do that. But yeah, now I think I only need to speak when I've got something to say.
What do you want people to walk away from the album with, or how do you want it to make them feel, if you can put that across?
I think it's layered, man. I think on the one hand, if anyone struggled with an unprovoked attack or racism, or someone treating them differently because they're poor or from a different background, I want them to feel seen and heard through my music. I want them to feel like it's a form of therapy for them, to feel that they're not alone. And then on the other hand, I want people that have maybe not had that experience to think about the world around them and how they can play their part on creating a safer community for the rest of us. Do you know what I'm saying? So yeah, hopefully people listen to it and they evaluate, and then, I don't know, go do some good stuff, man.
What is writing the album, what has it done for you?
It's got me an Avirex jacket, which is quite nice. But I didn't really get any closure from like the police or anything with what happened. So for me, it's provided me an element of peace, an element of closure, element of, you know, light at the end of the tunnel. And like, yeah, music just gives me life, man. It gives me like another opportunity to go again, something to turn my attention to. So yeah, it's just one of my lifelines that I've been very grateful for in my life.
Yeah, so I guess it sounds like that advice on the beginning, I think she mentions it being quite a weird thing to say or something, but it sounds like it's been good advice.
Yeah, obviously I don't want to gas her up too much because she's got a big head already, but yeah, no, love for the advice, Michaela, man.
Just because we're talking 50 years of hip-hop, and for some reason in hip-hop we're sort of obsessed with top fives, what are your like top five hip-hop records throughout your life that have sort of influenced you?
That's the kind of question you got to prepare me for, bro. There's so many. I would just say the top five that I say now might not be my consistent.
Yeah,
I'm saying it always changes, but I'd say B by Common is always a go-to for me. Mm. Always put that on in the crib. Say the Black Album by Jay-Z. I'd say Illmatic by Nas. Obviously a classic. Something more recent I've banged out is 2014 Forest Hills Drive, J. Cole. And then the fifth one, The Village Is On Fire, Guvna B, man. I'm gonna put my own one in there, man. What's yours? You can't just stick it on me like that, bruv.
So I'd probably go Kanye, My Beautiful Dark, just
the thing. Ah, bruv. I've got to do it again. I've got to put the college rough out in there. Sorry, you've got to give me six.
I'd say probably Kendrick, Damn.
Oh, bruv, I've got to do my whole list again.
The other three, which J are we going for? Maybe, I might go 444 today.
Yeah, girl.
Two other. I should have prepared for my own one, shouldn't I? Illmatic. And then Outkast, but which one?
Yeah.
Quem and I.
With hip hop though, you gotta do like a top 10 at least, man.
Yeah.
Top 5's too hard.
I do always say the same thing as you. It depends on the day, doesn't it? I don't. That's the thing with the top 5 question. I feel like it's a bit like it depends on your mood and it depends on sort of.
Yeah. Do you know my on the Nas thing? I think that because Illmatic is so special, people didn't really appreciate Stillmatic for what it was. I feel like Stillmatic is still a great album, but because it followed Illmatic, it doesn't get the respect it deserves.
Yeah, I guess it's that with anything with a sequel, it's gonna get compared to that.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
It's a good list though.
Yeah. What are your top 5 MCs?
Jay-Z, Nas, Tupac is up there for me. Got to put Wretch 3-2 in because I think from a UK perspective, he can go toe-to-toe with the best of them. And number 5, I'll just put DMX in there, man. Yeah, DMX in there. But again, that's for today. Tomorrow might be completely different.
To end the interview, we've got a gift for you from Chivas.
Oh, cheers. Right, it got my name on it and everything. Big ups, man. Oh, that's hard. Whiskey. I've got to take my time with this one. Might be gone in a week. Thank you, man.
No worries.